Sawadee ka. Good afternoon from Thailand and distinguished guests. Welcome to this very important event on World Press Freedom Day 2022. Let me introduce myself. I am Natha Gomonwadin from the Thai Public Broadcasting Service. Very honored to be moderator of this very important session on this very important day for journalists around the world. And it is more important than ever how professional journalists are working in this disruption in the uncertain context of geopolitical context and social context around the world. And to welcome you all, if you just join in, please select the option of the language. We provide the content in English and Thai. Just select the globe icon so you can listen in both Thai and English. And thank you for the participant organizations who arranged this important event, UNESCO Thai Journalists Association, TJA, and Faculty of Communication Art, Chulalongkorn University. The main topic of today's discussion is journalism under digital siege. If you check the social media figure of the social media users around the world, you could see how the number of social media users have been expanded exponentially in the past 5 years, of about 2 billion users in 2016 to about 4.2 billion users last year. That means half of the world population of 7.9 billion, and that means the context of journalists around the world in order to report and providing insight into users around the world who have different opinions, different view, fragmented opinions. So the question that are facing journalists nowadays is how we can cope with this uncertain context of geopolitical environment in which journalists are losing the role of being gatekeepers. And the role of being gatekeeper is now enable the government and organization belong to local government to have exercise their law and regulation to govern how journalists can be working online and offline. So the question is how journalism can survive and thrive in this digital era. That's the main topic of discussion of our seminar today. The format of the discussion, I'm very sorry if the atmosphere Okay. I'm so sorry if the atmosphere around me is quite noisy. So from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m., we will start from keynote address from organizer from 3 organizations. And then the upcoming discussion will be in Thai on bullying and survival of journalism under the digital siege. So now please let me proceed with welcoming speech by participating organizations. We will have three keynote speakers. Mr. Mongkhon Bang Prapha, President of Thai Journalists Association, TJA. Mr. Prida Akhara Chantachot, Dean, Faculty of Communication Art, Chulalongkorn University. And Mr. Shigeru Oyagi, Director of UNESCO Bangkok. So please let me first begin with Mr. Mongkhon Bang Prapha, President of Thai Journalists Association. TJA, please.
ครับ Thank you คุณณัฐาขอบคุณมากนะครับเมื่อพูดถึงวันเสรีภาพสื่อมวลชนโลกสิ่งที่
When we speak about the World Press Freedom Day, as myself as a professional journalist, I have been working in this industry from the very beginning. I would like to thank first of all the 3 sectors who have contributed to this day of the World Press Freedom Day. The first sector is the organizations that are involved. whether you are international organizations or the academic organization, academic institutions, and also the civil society organizations. All of these three sectors, three types of organizations, recognize the importance of the independence of the press. And also the second sector, I would like to thank the public, the general public, for recognizing the importance of the press and its independence, that the press is delivering to you the information. And also the third sector, I would like to thank my fellow press or members of the press for adhering to your code of conduct in your performance of your duties and to recognizing the freedom of the press as well, and also giving value to the word freedom of the press. So what is the value of the press? The value of the press will only occur when we can exercise the freedom to deliver the news and information to the general public. And that is reminds me of the motto or the sayings that we have for the World Press Freedom Day about a few years back, which is that freedom of the press equals the right to access to information of the public. And also the freedom of the press comes with responsibility. In the world of digital communication, even though we may have the general public who can pass on or share information, but at the moment, the acquisition of information may be as difficult as it has been, because the sharing of information most of the time are the sharing of opinions instead of facts. So I would like the press to recognize the importance of the acquisition or access to news and information. Use your freedom of the press to gain or to obtain the information, and also deliver that to the public as a compensation or as giving back to the society that has been working tirelessly to protect your freedom. Thank you.
Point and very essential point for journalists, that our freedom, press freedom, of course, comes with responsibility, and that's the great responsibility, given that we are living in the very uncertain context of journalists around the world. So next, let me move on to Mr. Brida Akkarachandachod, Dean, Faculty of Communication Arts, Chulalongkorn University. Please say a few words.
Thank you very much. So, distinguished guests, as the Faculty of Communication Arts is the university in Thailand that we provide courses on mass media, and we also recognize the importance of freedom of the press and freedom of expression as well, which is the fundamental rights of all humans. In the general context that is being disrupted nowadays, we can see a lot of uncertainties going on, and we can see like imminent changes that are happening in our everyday lives. So as educational institution, we have to understand, also adapt to the changing context that we're facing, and also the media landscape and educational landscape that are also changing as well. The Faculty of Communication Arts, Chulalongkorn University, we are very honored to have the opportunity from UNESCO to be acting as the organization for today's event, to recognize the freedom of the press. And also it is a very good opportunity for us to really review and also to go over, you know, the context and also the importance of communication and journalism. It is the opportunity for us to come to terms with what is freedom of the press nowadays. And also this is the opportunity for us to work hand in hand, you know, with at the national level and international level, whether it is with the TJA, iLaw, or the Office of Attorney General, or the Anti-Fake News Center, to host today's event. And also, it is a very good opportunity for us to really review the factors that are pressuring us, you know, or obstructing us in terms of communication and freedom of the press. And in this seminar, we can together take a look at how we can encourage or find a solution to overcome all these obstacles that are hindering the press or the media in Thailand, to ensure that the press in Thailand will have equivalent rights and freedom. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ka. Mr. Brida, Dean of Faculty of Communication Art, and he emphasized changing role of academic institution given that the media landscape is transforming very rapidly, and that's big challenge for university, how you have to cope with these changes, and especially with the changing context in providing the atmosphere or the surrounding ecosystem for the journalist to survive in this digital age. That's really important. Next, I'd like to move on to Mr. Shigeru Oyagi, Director of UNESCO Bangkok. Please say a few words.
Thank you. Distinguished speakers, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, remarks on behalf of UNESCO for today's event honoring World Press Freedom Day. Freedom of expression is a fundamental human right and a cornerstone of a democratic society, as enshrined in Article 19 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. With UNESCO's specific mandate to promote the free flow of ideas by word and image, the organization has been a staunch defender of freedom of expression and press freedom since the end of the World War II. As the distinguished Philippine-American journalist Maria Ressa stated in her Nobel Peace Prize lecture of just last year, without facts, you can't have truth. Without truth, you can't have trust. Without trust, we have no shared reality, no democracy, and it becomes impossible to deal with a world's existential problems. Climate, coronavirus, the battle for truth. Indeed, Ressa reminds us that global crisis highlights how the role of journalism in producing verified information in the public interest is more important than ever. To date, technological progress has reshaped the global media landscape and rapidly expanded people's access to information and alternative possibilities for free expression through social media networks. But at the same time, we are also witnessing the spread of disinformation, misinformation, and hate speech, all of which incites misunderstanding, confusion, discrimination, and even outright violence. These developments are raising increasing concerns over the weak transparency and accountability of internet companies. Distinguished participants, between 2016 and 2020, 400 journalists across the world were killed simply for doing their jobs. In Asia and the Pacific alone, this is now a dire situation. In terms of violence committed against journalists, the Asia-Pacific region is on par with Latin America and Caribbean, each with 123 journalists killed during that recent four-year period, the highest number of killing among all regions of the world. As the democratic space around the globe continues to shrink, journalists in Asia and the Pacific are facing an increasingly hostile working environment. Female journalists are particularly subject to harassment and threats, especially via online platforms. Even more worrying, while the number of killed journalists across the world during the period of 2016 and 2020 has almost decreased by 20%, the Asia-Pacific region is the only place where their number has increased by more than 30%. Equally notable is that close to 9 out of 10 cases of these killings remain judicially unsolved. This year's commemoration of World Press Freedom Day provides us with a unique opportunity to join in global efforts exploring the impact of digital transformation on freedom of expression and the safety of journalists, as well as media viability and public trust. We are especially pleased to have with us today two distinguished keynote speakers, Dr. Aim Simpen from the University of Sydney, who will discuss the situation of digital media and internet control in Thailand, and our colleague from UNESCO headquarters, Rachel Pollack, who will present UNESCO's current report, World Trends in Freedom of Expression and the Media Development. We also have with us distinguished academics, journalists, judicial actors, civil society activists, and representatives from Thai government agencies who will share their experiences in how digital transformation and advanced technologies used in the current media industry have directly affected them as rights holders and duty bearers. In closing, please allow me to express my special gratitude to the Faculty of Communication Arts of Chulalongkorn University and the Thai Journalists Association for co-hosting this very important event. I very much look forward to our continued collaboration. I wish you all a productive discussion. Thank you very much for your participation today.
Especially when you remind how different stakeholders in Thai society today are helping and collaborating in order to initiate this very important discussion, especially about the role of journalists being under the digital siege. And next, I'd like to invite Ms. Rachel Pollack, Program Specialist, Freedom of Expression and Safety Journalist Section from UNESCO. She would deliver keynote speech on World Trends Report on Freedom of Expression and Media Development. And I believe, Ms. Pollack, you will have about 10 minutes to deliver your keynote. Please.
Hi, hello everyone. Thanks very much for the invitation. It's really an honor to be here and to join you today. Here from Paris, where I work at UNESCO headquarters as a program specialist in freedom of expression and safety of journalists. I have a PowerPoint presentation. Maybe it can be loaded. Excellent. There we go. As the director of the Bangkok office mentioned, we have a series of reports called World Trends in Freedom of Expression and Media Development. You could go to the next slide, please. So this series actually comes from a mandate of UNESCO's General Conference in 2011, which asked the organization to monitor and report on trends in press freedom and the safety of journalists. So we have been publishing this series of reports since then. It's our flagship series, and we look at trends in media freedom, pluralism, independence, and the safety of journalists. Our latest global report starts at 2016 through 2021, and it has those four pillars of press freedom, as well as chapters on the theme of journalism as a public good and issues around data in the field. We also have a video here on the right side of the slide, but perhaps we can put that in the chat or watch it at the end. I invite you. It's a teaser that gives a little taste of the report. Next slide, please. So today I'll focus on the global report, which we just released in March. But the World Trends Report is actually an umbrella series for lots of publications that we put out in this field. We have a series of policy papers, which we call issue briefs. Our first one was in April 2020 on COVID-19, journalism and press freedom. We've also covered topics like the safety of journalists covering protests, safety of foreign correspondents, also the transparency of internet platform companies, which relates to today's discussion. We just put out actually about 3 weeks ago, a new policy paper on media viability. So the economic sustainability of the news media. We also have one on journalism and trauma. And then just today, we're releasing a new paper on journalism and whistleblowers, which is also very timely. Next slide. So to give you an idea of some of the major trends, again, echoing some of what's been said, we've seen over the last 5 years a drop in press freedom experienced by the majority of people in the world, actually by 85% live in a country in which the state of press freedom declined between 2016 and 2020. That is using data from the Varieties of Democracy Institute. We also see, as was mentioned, the killings of journalists have continued to be very, very high. We have 400 between 2016 and 2020. Going through 2021, that number comes to 455. We also have challenges to the news media faced by a drop in ad revenue, which is largely linked to the big tech companies, which have siphoned away most of the advertising revenue, so that newspaper ad revenue has now dropped by 50%. There are some positive signs. We see, for example, in access to information laws, the number of UN member states has now risen to 132. So there are reasons for optimism. Next slide. So to go into a little bit more specifics in these areas, as has been stated, the press freedom continued to decline. And this is really around the world, even in places that have historically had strong democracies. There's this 85% figure from the Varieties of Democracy Institute that I mentioned. We're also seeing a rise in new types of restrictive laws around the world. We observed in at least 44 countries since 2016 have adopted or amended laws banning things like so-called fake news or disinformation. And these laws are often overly vague. They have disproportionate punishments, even jail sentences, and many more have laws that are under discussion. I'll just say that my presentation really covers a broad picture of the global landscape, and I won't go into specific country examples, but this will give some overall context. If we look at the digital sphere, there are also threats. And so in online content, it's actually governments request a lot of content removal from major platforms like Meta, Twitter, Google, and that number has doubled in the last 5 years. We've also seen a trend in internet shutdowns, and that's when either the entire internet is cut in a country or a region, a city, or there are bans on specific platforms or messaging apps. And so we see that the number of internet shutdowns had reached a peak in 2019 at 213 shutdowns around the world. This is according to the NGO Access Now. Next slide. Next slide, please. And so we see in terms of the safety of journalists, again, very, very concerning. We should note that there has been a drop over the last 10 years and the last 5 years, especially in the killings of journalists. And UNESCO tracks that every time a journalist is killed, we put out a press release condemning the killing and asking for an update on the status of the judicial investigation. So we have seen a drop there. This has so far changed in 2022, linked to the war in Ukraine. We'll see what the numbers are there, but overall there's been a drop. But at the same time, there has been a rise in the number of imprisoned journalists. So there are many non-lethal threats that also persist. Women journalists do face specific threats, especially online. UNESCO did a survey with the International Center for Journalists, which found that they surveyed over 900 journalists. of those who responded to this question, 73% had experienced online violence connected to their work, and 20% had experienced offline violence linked to online violence. So again, a very concerning trend. Next slide, please. So this global report also looked at specifically the topic of media viability and the idea of journalism as a public good, which is the main theme of the report. And so this is arguing both that journalism serves the good of the public, but also that it qualifies by the economic definition of a public good, and that it will not, there is some market failure and it won't be sustainable unless there is more public support. So UNESCO partnered with Economist Impact, which is a think tank branch of the Economist magazine, to do original research on this topic of media viability. We found that Google and Meta now receive half of all digital ad spend. As mentioned before, at the same time in this period, newspaper ad revenue dropped by half. We also saw a drop in newspaper circulation linked to the COVID-19 pandemic. That dropped by 13% between 2019 and 2020. Also linked to COVID, we found that journalists experienced a salary cut. One-fifth of journalists who were surveyed, again, by the International Center for Journalists. And if we look at that graph, it's very clear that the, is that better? Hello? And maybe someone can put in the chat if this is, I see you are muted. I was direct. I hope this is better now. If you have any difficulties hearing me, please put in the chat. Let's see. I'm seeing a message in the chat that it
is. Yes, Rachel, you can go ahead.
Oh, you can go ahead. Okay,
yeah,
okay.
You're good.
Okay,
you're good.
I'm good. Okay. Yeah. Perfect. Okay. I received a message in the chat that I was muted. So I was worried for a few minutes that you also missed the last 5 minutes of the presentation, but I'm very glad that was not the case. Excellent. Okay. So yeah, just to look at this graph quickly, I think it's quite powerful to see this and the rise in ad revenue that's gone. So when we say internet, we're basically referring to these two companies, Google and Meta, which is now Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp, and you see the drop at the same time in traditional news media. Next slide, please. So, looking at these trends and press freedom, and so in media freedom, pluralism, independence, and the safety of journalists, as well as in media viability. We have a number of observations. We can think of them in three main areas. So first, we need governments and also other key actors in this space to support the economic viability of the news media. While doing that, we need to respect the professional independence of journalists. We also need to further develop media and information literacy so that citizens develop critical thinking skills and they can distinguish between reliable, verified information and unverified information. And then lastly, to enact and reform media law, laws and policies, regulations to support free and pluralistic news that is in line with international standards on freedom of expression. So I will stop there. Maybe last slide has my contact information, which I can also put into the chat here. And if you would like have any further questions or information that you'd like to share, please don't hesitate to contact me. And again, thank you to the organizers for the invitation. And I wish everyone a happy World Press Freedom Day. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Rachel Pollack, for your overview of the study by UNESCO on World Trends Report on Freedom of Expression and Media Development. It's quite alarming how media revenue has been on decline, and that's of course affecting well-being of journalists around the world, while the context is getting more and more uncertain, especially how the internet company is being influential in the life and well-being in order to report by journalists around the world. So next, let me move on to Dr. A.M. Sin Peng, an awarded researcher from the project Cyber Repression and Political Protests in Thailand, and a senior lecturer at the University of Sydney. She would deliver a keynote address on Thailand digital media, authoritarianism, and internet controls. So please, Dr. Sin Peng.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me
for the presentation today. I will be delivering it in English, but I speak fluent Thai, so hopefully if I can finish a bit earlier, maybe I can also discuss some issues in Thai. I'm really glad to be following on Rachel's presentation, as my talk would actually is focusing on resilience and entrepreneurship in times of autocracy with regards to Thai digital media organization. Next slide, please. And I'd like to bring up a quote based on a study that I conducted, that every single media organization in Thailand that I work, that were interviewed, has said, the government is watching us every day. And I think this quote is important, not because there's actual evidence by organizations that they have been monitored, but it's the perception of them being monitored that really matters, because that perception, whether or not substantiated by actual evidence, guides the way media organization actually conducts themselves and what kind of journalism it would conduct if it believes that it's being monitored by the government. Next slide, please. Another click, please. And another click. So this is a graph that basically shows, based on the data actually drawn from the Digital Society project, the same project that Rachel uses data for some of the reports. It's just to plot Thailand, you know, in relation to all the other countries in terms of the degree to which government social media monitoring and arrests on political content is going on. So the lower the country is, meaning the scores closest to zero on both sides of the exits, the worse the situation. So in comparison to the rest of the world, Thailand's performing particularly bad on both counts when organizations are being asked whether or not they feel that social media is being monitored and the extent to which political content have led to arrest. Next, please. But today's talk will not focus necessarily on how terrible the situation in Thailand is in terms of government censorship and content censorship, as well as the degree of repression organizations feel, but that I wanted this talk to be something that we can share, that we can improve upon in a terrible situation, right? So this talk would actually focusing on what kind of resilience or entrepreneurship we can develop and we can nurture amongst media organization that we can actually improve the situation, regardless of the repressive political and economic and media environment. So the questions that I would like to pose for this talk are, how do Thai digital media organizations respond to increasingly autocratic media environment? What factors drive a thriving media organization given the current situation? And what impacts has the pandemic had on the sustainability of digital media organizations, specifically to Thailand? Next, please. And this talk is based on a study that I was part of, Inflection International, that focused on addressing digital media organizations from 12 countries around the world, which included the study of 201 media organizations, 15 of which are drawn from Thailand, as you can see in the slide here, Pachatai, the Isan Record, the Momentum, the Matter, Thai Publica, Green News, Echo, Pattaya News, Thai Inquirer, People, Disrupt, Samnakkal Isara, The Standard, 101 World, and Coconut. So we only focus on digital native media organizations, so organizations that start as a digital organization, because looking at their development and evolution give us a better indication of how digital media organizations that are actually emerged as already digital organizations are doing given the current internet environment. And this includes 500 survey questions as well as in-depth interviews. Next, please. So what do we find when we study this? We find that these organizations did not actually stay away from hot button issues. Even though they're digital media organization natives, which means that they came out of, you know, digital platforms directly, they didn't have they didn't have the traditional offline version. They focused largely on human rights, politics, gender, health, and environment, all issues that you expect these organizations to face a lot of resistance and monitoring and potential censorship. Example here is, you know, Echo, which I will talk a little bit more later about. This video had more than a million views, was focusing on the issue of potentially canceling graduation, which is a big political issue in Thailand. And it didn't shy away from these very sensitive issues. Next, please. And we find that 100% of the organizations that I studied have reported being monitored by the government, but none of them have actually lost revenue as a result of pushing sensitive political issues in their content, and that they are fighting back, especially against DDoS attacks, which is the most important form of digital attacks against digital media organizations, through the use of defensive software, all of which that I've mentioned here are free, Cloudflare, Project Shield, and Deflect. So 25% of all the organizations reported that they had their content removed by social media social media moderators, and that they had faced both a censorship from tech platform, censorship from government, and self-censorship. Next, please. When asked about the degree of media freedom and how safe their journalists felt, 51% of all the media, Thailand and other countries, have reported they have been harassed, some of which received direct threats and suffered DDoS attacks, and a small percentage actually were victims of physical attacks themselves. Journalists who are most at risk of harassment and attacks are photojournalists that are using cameras. And as I mentioned earlier, DDoS attack is the most common form of cyber attack organizations receive, and that they have chosen to fight back. Next, please. Within looking at the business model, which is something I don't think we talk too much about when we think of press freedom, when we think of internet censorship or internet repression, but it's something that is crucially important to media organization, is how do they get by, right? Given the political environment, but also the financial environment. And as Rachel mentioned, a lot of the tech companies are actually making money out of the backs of the work of journalists and media organizations. So how do they make money? How do they make revenue? And for some, how do they even make a profit? This is the snapshot of Southeast Asia. So Thailand is included in this. And it turns out that, in fact, Thai digital media organizations have the most profitable media organizations in comparison to the rest of the region. Not all of them are profitable, but the ones that are profitable, or the really profitable ones. And that, in fact, it only takes them 2 years since the establishment to turn themselves around and make the highest level of revenue in the tier four, for these organizations. And when you break down by the revenue income, there is even spread across from, you know, making no revenue at all, which is the case often for nonprofit media organization, up to very high degree of very high level revenue. So there's a massive inequalities within the Thai media organizations in terms of the degree to which they're profitable or making revenue. And this revenue reporting is consistent prior to and after the COVID-19 pandemic. The biggest source of revenue for these organizations is grants. Grants from private foundations or philanthropic organization. The vast majority of the grants actually come from Google, and to a lesser extent, Facebook. For Thai media organizations, they also receive quite a lot of grants from government agencies within Thailand, and to a lesser extent, international government agencies. The second source of revenue is advertising by national advertising, which is an important source. But for the Thai media organizations that are doing well, ad revenue from within the country are actually the number one source of revenue for the most successful Thai media, digital media organization. Next, please. So how do the profitable, successful digital media organizations in Thailand, how do they do it? What were some of the important factors that helped drive financial sustainability and success of the digital media organization? The number one factor, and this is something that not many digital media organizations are endowed with, is the startup capital, right? To have the initial money from the founders were really critical in setting up the digital media organization for success. But they're not the only factors. Having high initial investment alone isn't enough to guarantee success. Having a dedicated sales staff, at just one person focusing on sales and business development, actually increased revenue by 6 times. And this is something I think we don't talk about when we talk about press freedom or journalists. We think about, oh, what kind of things that we can do to improve the level of safety for journalists. But in fact, we actually need to put more attention to looking at how we can help these digital media organizations survive financially and thrive financially. And one of the things that is important is to actually have a sales and business development person in the organization, someone who actually knows how to do sales and how to market the organization. This is not something that a lot of founders I spoke to of these organizations thought about initially, because often digital media organizations are founded by journalists themselves. These are people who are trained to write content, write stories, are good narrators, but they're not always good with money. And this is something we underemphasize when we talk about financial and in terms of viability of digital media organizations, something that we need to focus on. The main revenue source, again, are actually ads for Thai media organization and content creation for non-clients. So the fact that you have the right talent, the right people to market yourself, are able to actually create content and provide that as contracts, are actually really good for digital media organization and allow them to use the revenue that they gain to focus on pushing boundaries on sensitive political issues without suffering financial consequences as a result. So successful, thriving digital media organizations in Thailand actually spend a lot of money on getting the right talent, particularly sales, business development, and content. types of talent. Next, please. So the three C's that are important for the Thai digital media organizations are content, collaboration, and courage. And I think courage in particular, we don't often talk about as the key to success. We talk about courage as something that could lead us to, you know, things like harassment, but we require courage as well. So this is content from Echo again that I mentioned. Echo is one of the most successful case of digital media organizations in Thailand. This video that they created focused on how do young Thai Muslims fall in love. And I wanted to showcase this because there's a few things I want to notice. The first thing is subtitles in Thai. In fact, there are subtitles in Thai, not because the lady in the video wasn't speaking Thai. She was speaking Central Thai, not a Southern dialect. But in every single video of Echo, there are Thai subtitles. So when I asked one of the editors and founders, Khun Cham, of Echo, I said, why do you have subtitles on your content? And he said, we noticed that a lot of the people who consume our videos do it under mobile phones in public places, which means that they can't always turn on the sound. So we put the subtitle there to allow public viewing of content without, you know, needing to have a headphone or what have you. And that says so much about an organization that's able to really get to understand the consumer and their behavior, right? To the level of being able to create the content displaying subtitles because they really understand that's what their consumers want. To showcase something quite political, all right, this video is really political because when you actually watch it, it's talking a lot about minority rights, about how many Thais don't really understand how young Thai Muslims live or fall in love. And it also demonstrates the important partnership with the PEN here. It's a Pattani-based organization to produce this kind of content that can draw upon the real local people from the area to speak their voice. So content, collaboration, courage do make a successful digital media organization, even when they focus on highly political issues. And this is something we need to talk more about in terms of, you know, finding the ways to improve the work of journalists in Thailand. Next slide, please. What else is then important for the success of a thriving digital media organization in the Thai case and more broadly? Content is no longer the only king, but data actually is the new king. Big data analytics skills is absolutely crucial for content marketing. And as I mentioned earlier, Echo found now, you know, through understanding the statistics and metrics for consumption of their content, what type of things their consumer might like or want, and what would it look like. And the important thing about the emphasis of big data analytics skills isn't that you need to hire someone, you know, a data scientist to be part of the organization. If you have the funds, that sounds great. But a lot of the organizations that I spoke to that do data analytics on their organizations, especially in the performance of their content, are people who are actually using either free tools online or teach themselves how to do something on their own. These are not people who were trained to do this initially. They train themselves and they use freely available tools. So it's not that you can invest in talent of someone who already has the skill, or you can develop the talent within the organization because you have the vision and the leadership to see that these skills are actually crucial to the financial sustainability and viability of the organizations, and to conduct in-house research to keep, to understand that consumer behavior does change and is dynamic. It's not something static. I mean, I can give an example. When I talk to the media organizations in Thailand that are quite successful, they're able to give me, the editors that I spoke to, they're able to give me statistics of how they're doing immediately. Whereas some of the organizations that are far less successful, took them weeks to give me some indication of how many people actually come onto their website or view on their Facebook. They have no idea, right? And in fact, they outsource it to an intern who may or may not have been paid to give the statistics. They don't know. So you're flying blind in a way, and hoping that the content would work, but you don't actually know yourself and have that those statistics with you to help guide the kind of content and the look of the content that would work. Next, please. So how do we increase openness and safety amongst media organizations in Thailand? I believe that we need creativity and courage, both of which actually reduce self-censorship. As I mentioned, all of the organizations that we studied reported they're being monitored by the government, but they've also reported that this has no bearing on the political issues that they want to push in Thailand, that they had not suffered any loss of revenue because they had the courage to actually go after and publish and create content on politically and socially sensitive issues. They need to have key contacts when in trouble regarding content. And this include contacts like contacts within the social media organizations, contacts for pro bono lawyers, as the third point, access to pro bono legal assistance, contacts for technical issues. They need to have those people at their reach, even though they're not employed or, you know, on a payroll as staff. They need to seek collaboration and partnership however they can. And collaboration and partnership tends to help create content and co-ownership of content that then help to grow audience for both organizations. They also need to gain knowledge on content policy of social media platforms. Most of the people that I spoke with who are basically editors or founders of media organizations in Thailand didn't really understand what content is allowed and not allowed on any of the social media platforms that they heavily rely on. They didn't have a clue. Like, you know, when I asked about hate speech, you know, what Facebook, how Facebook defines hate speech, no idea. All of that information is actually publicly available in multiple languages. And just getting yourself or somebody in your staff familiar with the actual content policy of the platforms you actually use is actually really important, because it gives you some safeguard in terms of understanding what's allowed, what's not allowed, and recourse to when trouble emerges, what are the things you can do and can't do in terms of if someone's asking for content removal and those sorts of things. Just having the knowledge of the policy is really crucial. Next, please. How do we then increase financial sustainability? There's really no point in fighting for more freedom for media organizations if they don't exist, because they can't survive in such a difficult financial environment for media organizations in general, but particularly digital media organizations. The number one factor is to have access to all sorts of free assistance that are freely available for media organization. For example, there's a Southeast Asia Technical Assistance Initiative that actually provides free technical service to media organizations who may not have someone on staff who can give them, you know, social media metrics and statistics, website traffic, you know, trying to figure out what kind of trying to set up some kind of software to fight against DDoS attacks. There's actually assistance specifically for Southeast Asian media organizations, including Thai media organizations, set up for this. Right, getting grants, which is my last point, getting grants from organizations like Luminate would actually provide a free technical person for you for a year for free, you know, to get things like, you know, metrics performance, to do big data analysis, to build some knowledge around business development in a digital media environment. That is freely available, and that can be provided to organizations for no charge, right? As we just need to apply. So a lot of the Thai media organizations that I spoke to don't apply for grants very much, definitely not international grants. And I know that there are barriers in terms of, you know, grant writing is a skill, having the right English language skill to be applied for these types of grants is crucial, but just an awareness that these grants actually do exist and can really help bring in greater, you know, viability for the company, but also more data analytics skills, more ability to get their content to more people, to even push for more politically sensitive topic, is really important. And it's something that isn't appreciated or even aware, you know, many media organizations are not aware of this. Next, please. And so for funders, for organizations that would like to help digital media organizations in Southeast Asia, in Thailand, the things that they can do, I think, you know, call for action is what Rachel was saying earlier. What kind of call for action? We need more tech and business training for journalists, not just, you know, how to write content that will go viral or how to protect themselves against harassment. Those things matter, but equally matter is tech and business training, actually, to help bring the organization to the next step. We should also make it easier for journalists to find and qualify for pro bono services. A lot of these services are free, and they can really help increase skills and qualifications of the people in the organization. But to find them and to qualify for them are not always easy, and the document might not be in the local language, might be difficult to access. So some of these things that we can do to make it easier for organizations to get help. And grants also should be targeted more to increase entrepreneurship and resilience, right? I think we accept that probably in the next 5 years or so, the trend of digital autocracy is going to continue. So what do we do about that? How can we not just survive, but thrive as a media organization, given the situation, right? Given this, and we know from the Thai case that I just spoke about, that there are really successful organizations who focus on politically sensitive issues, but thrive. So this can be done and has been done in Thailand. So we can do this if we can push for more skills and for more awareness of the technical and business skills that are as important as the content and creativity skills that are needed amongst our journalists, but particularly the leadership of the digital media organizations. Next, please. So I think that's my last slide. Yes, so in summary, the situation of media freedom and internet freedom in Thailand is not good. It's actually very bad when compared to other countries. But what can we do to increase resilience and entrepreneurship amongst journalists, amongst media organization leaders, is what I'm leaving you with today. We can do this by pushing for more awareness on the technical and entrepreneurship business development side of skills, to encourage more journalists and more media organization leaders to invest even in free tools to help increase those skills, because they would help increase financial viability of the organizations and allow this organization to weather through a pretty difficult and highly repressive media environment. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aim Sin Peng. Very uplifting research and very particular aspect on journalists, how to thrive, survive and thrive in this uncertain digital world, especially you hit the nail on the head exactly on entrepreneurship skill for and technical skill and sales skill for journalists. And that is really crucial because it's not only about being the best journalist in the world, but it's about all the on-hand capacity. So I just like to pursue one more question. As you do research on these digital media organizations, how do you see that can nurture talent or the fundamental of being professional journalist and to survive financially as well? Do you see they have to compromise on this? Because you mentioned aspect that they are doing so well in terms of generating income from their digital media. But how to maintain the high quality of their content as well to meet the professional standard of journalists?
That's a great question. I think at the leadership level, they need to recognize, okay, what are our main sources of revenue? What is bringing us money? And can we still pursue what we want to pursue in terms of content and make money? So in one of the organizations that is successful, that I won't mention the name, they realized that a lot of their revenues come from using their own skills to do projects unrelated to their own media organization. So they do that and they use the money to then create content on issues they really care about. And it's the division of labor. I think it's recognizing that you need to make money because you need to feed your staff. And in order to keep talent, it requires money because otherwise they go work for somebody else easily, right? And especially in how to motivate your staff. So they have the business model for how they would get their revenue. And then they try to then push the content on political issues that they care about as a separate stream, as more of this is our dream if we had the money, and this is how we're making money. And I think recognizing that is so important because you realize, you know, maybe you can't do both at the same time. They did admit that sometimes when they're trying to push for more political issues with the people they're paying them to create content, they said no. And that's okay. And I think accepting that, but finding the space and always staying committed to key issues you care about is really in the DNA of the organization, and recognizing that from the beginning. So when they hire staff who want to stay because they too believe in this DNA, right? It's not just working for an organization, but believing in what this organization is capable of changing in society. And so that's how you cultivate loyalty. That's how you, you know, basically demand your staff that if you want to be part of this broader change, you can do this. And that actually incentivizes them to develop the additional skills that would help them do that job. So, you know, Echo, for example, whenever they do really political stuff, it doesn't always even go well. But when they're doing it on the side, you know, mixing politics with food, they do really well. And so seeing that you can do both and creatively is really important.
I see, that's really important. It's like being artist in the capital world. You have to something do or create something that you don't quite like, but generate income to sustain your artistic talent. That's very crucial. And thank you again for Dr. M. Sinpeng for your research. This is very valuable, and I think it will contribute to what we can learn more to lift up and to increase standard of the journalists in Thailand in this digital world, which is really crucial. Thank you again. And that wraps up to the end of this very first session. And I'd like to thank you again to Mr. Mongkhon Bang Prapha, Mr. Brida Akhara Chantachot, Mr. Shigeru Oyagi, Director of UNESCO Bangkok, Rachel Pollack, Program Specialist of UNESCO, and Dr. M. Sinpeng, to that you exchange your view and your thoughts for World Press Freedom Day, how the journalists should survive in this digital state. So now let me bring the next session up to Dr. Pichitra on the new session. Sorry, I can't find the name. I'm so sorry, Dr. Pichitra. Thank you.
สวัสดีค่ะมากนะคะเซสชันนี้นะคะจะเป็นภาษาไทยนะคะโดยไดนา
So this session is going to be conducted in Thai. So on behalf of the Faculty of Communication Arts, Chulalongkorn University, we're going to conduct this panel discussion in Thai with English interpretation. But before we go in to our topic of discussion today, maybe I'd like to throw a question to Kun Natha. So since you have been here in the media world for a long time, and we've met each other in BBC, and we've worked extensively in the international media firm. It's a public broadcasting company, and you're now in with Thai PBS. So, you know, in this World Press Freedom Day today, maybe you can share your thoughts a little bit on Thai journalism and what are the challenges that we're facing in comparison to foreign press. So after hearing from Dr. M, I think it's really reflecting on the current situation right now, you know, between the old media and the mainstream media that has been challenged with the digital disruption. Because conventionally, you know, the media is in competition. BBC is also experiencing the problems with funding as well, which they are gaining from the people's taxes. And the television or mainstream media is not gaining a lot of attention as much as before. And also the proliferation of the new audience, and a lot of them has fluctuated to the digital media. So it's a challenging landscape, you know, for a globally. And BBC is actually a public media as well as Thai PBS. And everyone is actually fighting for eyeballs. So as the public media, we have to keep going and keep thriving and weathering through all these obstacles, so we cannot actually be too adventurous in our presentation. But if we were to retain this, you know, professionalism and standard, how do we conduct ourselves? And also we need to also gear up for the digital world. And this is actually definitely the challenge that we are facing, both in BBC and Thai PBS. You know, I'm speaking as a former BBC fellow members. The context here and the organization here, we have to keep pushing the limits. Being in Thailand is not easy, as mentioned by Dr. Aim, because we are being monitored closely, you know, with this political context in Thailand. But we have to keep going. But and how we can adapt and be resilient in this digital world, and also, you know, promoting new talents. So my a big moral support for all journalists and journalism. Thank you, Kun Natha, for taking over that first session. So with the second session, we are going to have a panel discussion on safety of journalists and media viability under digital siege. So we are conducting this online 100%. So I'm going to try to call on all our panelists. We have selected panelists in order to create this equilibrium on people, you know, working in media, from NGO and the journalists themselves, as well as the public sector and academia. So I'm going to go through all the panelists and see if they are here with us. First, I'd like to welcome, I think he is in Germany, but he is logging on to join us. The first panelist is Dr. Jantira Sombat Poon Siri. She is from the German Institute for Global and Area Studies. Can you please say hello? Good afternoon, everybody. What time are you over there? So it's 10 in the morning. But you're not the first to go, but I'd like to just see that you are here. The second panelist who is going to speak first, and he's going to share his experience and the challenges as a media outlet. I'd like to welcome Mr. Jirapong Prasad Polakrang, representative from Thai Journalists Association, TJA. Good afternoon, everybody. The third panelist representing from the public sector he is involved with anti-fake news and fact-checking from the public sector, Mr. Santipa Permongkonsap, Deputy Director of Anti-Fake News Center Thailand from MDES. Good afternoon, everyone. And another panelist representing the public sector as well. So from the Office of the Attorney General, Dr. Mark Turan Wong, our public prosecutor. Good afternoon. And last but not least, I hope he is here because this morning he was summoned by the court. I'd like to welcome Kun Ying Chip Atanon, Program Manager from iLaw.
Good afternoon. กลับทันแล้วครับอาจารย์มาทันแต่ต้นเลยครับได้ประกันตัวเร็วขอบคุณครับได้ๆๆมาคุยกัน
นะคะในวงนี้เนี่ยจริงๆแล้วเซสชั่นจะเป็นอย่างนี้ค่ะ So considering our panelists, the plan is we're going to go first round and maybe each about 7 to 8 minutes, and then we will speak particularly in the freedom of press and its current status. Maybe hear from Kun Jirapong first. As a journalist, how long have you been a journalist? 18 years. So where have you worked before? So from Nao Na newspaper, Nation TV, Spring News, and now I'm currently in Tan Setikit. So you've always been with a newspaper, a news media. Well, I am now, you know, a deputy editor of online news. So maybe can you tell us, you know, as a first panelist, since you've been in this sector for 18 years, do you see pressure from technology or the government or the laws? Has that been a challenge to how you conduct your work? So thank you for your question. I think journalists these days are facing such great challenge in work from 18 years ago. Because before, I would say to journalists that you only have, you need more than one topic, you know, to write about. Like 10 years after, journalists have to take photo as well and also write news and be on Twitter. And currently today, one journalist, whether you're from a newspaper or television or online. So it's not enough that you're just writing news or taking photograph. You need to have presence on online platform as well. So aside from reporting the news, you know, being able to edit your clips and also exist on online platform is excellent, because the trend of all the media right now, newspaper, all newspapers, we have a lot of 50% of returned newspapers. You know, out of, we have 50%, if you get 500 back from 1,000, and television is very competitive as well, because they need to maintain that rating by bringing in those soaps, operas, and series. So everyone needs to be on top of their games. And also online media or journalists online, they survive with trends and hashtag, the whatever is trending that day. They will be committed that day to focus on that hashtag that's trending. So people who are monitoring the news will assign, you know, their journalists to be in the field and going through that news in order to focus on what's trending. For example, Google trend today is Tangmo case. So, and journalists will have to go, and they have to think about who are they going to, what they're going to cover on that topic in order for their news to be catching that trend. So the challenge here is one journalist. In the past, you have, you know, a journalist at the parliament, at the ministry. But today, if a journalist, for example, in entertainment news, journalists, you know, working in economics, they need to be able to fluidly move over and take over and cover that entertainment news as well. So they need to be multi-skilled. They need to have a multi know-how. They need to have depth and breadth of all that topics in order to be able to cater to the audience online and on television. So there's a lot of adapting to be done here. So for the past 4 or 5 years, there has been a disruption to the media, you know, with the disruption of technology, and some of the positions that has been obsolete, you know, in the editorial team. For example, proofreading. You know, there is no one sitting there to proofread any news articles anymore, or photographers. So we had a loss, about 800 jobs loss in the first round of disruption. And then together with COVID pandemic, 2,000 jobs were lost, 3,000 all in the sector. Positions were obsolete, and those with high salary. So senior journalists in the media have, you know, gone off the grid. So these junior journalists, they're growing very fast. And, you know, in their late 20s, early 30s, they're now, you know, taking up the editorial desk. So the chain of command is, you know, discussing among these new generations of journalists. So if editors will have to assign senior journalists, what would happen? Then that there is clearly generation gap that exist. Young journalists, very senior editors, when they communicate, you know, they need to have very close a meeting in order to for them to be on the same page. So what has been the challenge for us? So what's going to happen is that there will be less, you know, in-depth news. because people, you know, has been followed. The changes has been fast. But if you see these new important topics like corruption that goes in depth, you don't really see those news anymore. But so it's actually the structure, right? The result of the structure, but not being monitored by the government. Yes, partially. Well, in my opinion, these corruption news or exercising the power of the state is one thing, and being influenced by these big business for them not to be under scrutiny is one thing. But when a lot of people have left the sector or the industry, there has been no replacement, right? Because if you lose 10 and you gain 2, and that 2 that you've gained are just following that Google trend to follow that current trend daily. So if you've seen the traditional, if you've seen the television, half an hour from the break, they're trying to, you know, present those dramas that are going on just to gain that rating. And then once they have that, it can be extracted to be virals on the internet. So that's a really, really the challenge on how one journalist would have to be competitive with the new ways of work. So you need to have that depth and breadth. And also journalists will have to work under the new ways of command. So it's just like one journalist will need to deliver a lot of news per day. I've had journalists crying, you know, like he went to 4 news because he wasn't good at anything he covered. So the challenge is the policy from the media organization that needs to be backed up by sponsored through advertising. Second challenge is the generation gap and the work operation that is so different from different generations to cater to social media. And online has clear key performance indicator that one news would have to get how many views. For example, a team, we will have 300,000 baht, and that team will need to deliver such and such news to cover that 300,000 baht. If you don't cover that 300,000 baht, they will be reevaluating the team members. So this is reality. And there has been pressure from the executive level on how they have to deliver to their budget, and also advertising. And sometimes the news or contents deliver is, you know, not in agreement with the advertising sponsors, because it's so easy for a journalist to receive complaint. Because the people can just get calls, and editors will have to take that complaint. That was before, but now, you know, sometimes people can send message through LINE application or Facebook. So it's, you know, we journalists are on a very slippery slope here, and how we are going to able to thrive. And how they want to try to deliver the best news, best content. But, you know, with this ease of communication online, they're easily contacted. Well, so many channels, and also there are changes on work and disruption, and also digital disruption and COVID. So maybe let's turn over to Khun Ying Chi from iLaw. Aside from being that human rights defender, you also deliver your own content. Have you been harassed before? Because you function a little bit like a watchdog. on how you verify the works of the government.
ครับก็เจอเยอะฮะมันก็มีเพดานอยู่นะครับเวลาพูดเรื่องการเมืองพูดเรื่องที่มันอ่อนไหวในประเทศไทยนะครับก็แต่ละคนก็รักษาเพดานไม่เท่ากันถ้าเพดานสูงโอกาสที่จะมี engagement ดี respond ดีก็มีมากกว่าถ้าเพดานต่ำก็เงียบหน่อยนะครับก็เป็นธรรมดานะเป็นความท้าทายในยุคน
ี้นะครับ
เมื่อกี้ฟังคุณจิรพงษ์พูดแล้วก็คิดตามแล้วก็พอเหี่ยวไปบ้างนะฮะก็มันก็เป็นความเป็นจริงที่เผชิญกันอยู่แต่ว่ามันก็เป็นธรรมชาตินะครับคือพอมันเป็นอย่างนี้แล้วแต่พอเราดูตัวเองนะผมก็ไม่ได้อ่านหนังสือพิมพ์มานานแล้วที่ออฟฟิศพิมพ์อยู่ประมาณ3ปีที่แล้วนะครับแล้วปรากฏมันก็ยังเรียบอยู่อย่างนั้นแต่ละวันมันก็ยังเรียบอยู่เช้าจดเย็นก
็
เลยตัดสินใจเลิกรับไปนะครับแล
้
วก็แต่ก็ไม่ได้อ่านข่าวน้อยลงนะครับจริงๆอ่านข่าวมากขึ้นด้วยซ้ำแต่ว่าอ่านทางอื่นทางโซเชียลมีเดียหรือเราอยากรู้อะไรเราก็เซิร์ชได้นะครับนี่มันเซิร์ชไม่ได้กว่าจะหาเจอว่าข่าวนี้อยู่หน้าไหนอ่านตอนหน้า21อ่านตอนหน้า17แต่ไม่เจอสักทีนะครับมันก็เป็นธรรมชาติที่พอโลกมันเปลี่ยนธุรกิจมันก็เปลี่ยนนี้เนี่ยภายใต้ความท้าทายปัจจุบันในประเด็นที่ผมเตรียมมาก็คือสถานการณ์เป็นอย่างที่คุณจิรพงษ์พูดจริงๆว่าสื่อก็จำเป็นต้องอยู่รอด
We want to, you know, present something that are beneficial for the public. But some, those kind of stories are not popular among the public. I'm not sure, you know, whether you will agree with me, but I think the viability, you know, as of now,
but
of course, I would say that that would be the short-term viability, you know, solution, but in the long term, you cannot always catch the trend, you cannot always, you know, follow the hashtags,
you cannot
always do that because you are competing with about a million people. You know, the eyewitnesses, the YouTubers, the TikTok, our content creator, we cannot compete with them. So the long-term
ให้แน่นให้
chance of viability
แล้วคนก็ต้องรู้ว่าในเวลาที่มันมีข่าวร้อนมันมีดีเบตในสังคมเนี่ยมันมีเรื่องที่คนสนใจเนี่ยถ้าอ่านสื่ออาชีพเนี่ยคุณจะได้สิ่งที่คุณภาพกว่าถูกต้องกว่าเชื่อถือได้กว่าครบถ้วนรอบด้านแล้วนิ่งกว่าแต่ไม่ได้ร้อนไลน์วินาทีแบบ Twitter อะไรแบบนี้ครับขณะที่โอเคบนโซเชียลมีเดียมันมีสิ่งที่ผิดบ้างมีความเห็นเยอะมีข้อเท็จจริงน้อยแต่ถ้าฉันกรอก URL ของสื่อเจ้านี้เข้าไปแล้วเข้าไปดูเนี่ยคนจะคาดหมายได้ว่ามันมีสิ่งที่มีคุณภาพกว่าสิ่งที่เห็นบน Twitter ผมคิดว่าอันนี้น่าจะเป็นทางรอดนะครับไม่แน่ใจเหมือนกันว่าเป็นไปได้ไหมแล้วมันจะทำให้ยอดคลิกเนี่ยมันเพิ่มขึ้นโดยที่คนมันเข้าไปหาข้อมูลเองแต่ไม่ได้มาจำเป็นต้องพึ่งกระแสตื่นตูมบนโซเชียลมีเดียนะครับนี่คือภาพฝันที่อยากจะเห็นว่าในสนามที่มันร้อนและทุกคนสื่อสารได้เนี่ยสื่อต้องดีกว่าต้องเก่งกว่าต้องแน่นกว่าต้องครบถ้วนและถูกต้องกว่านะครับแต่ว่าทีนี้เนี่ย
มีมาแล้วนะคะเหมือนอาจารย์เอมเมื่อกี้จากเลคเชอร์อาจารย์เอมก็ไม่ใช่เลคเชอร์เป็นปาฐกถาที่อาจารย์เอมมาจากงานวิจัยแกก็บอกเหมือนกันว่าสื่อออนไลน์จริงสื่อออนไลน
์ that the online media organizations are making so much profit once you know that you know once you have the system in place there is a viability for you
หลายประเทศเนี่ยผมเห็นว่าเขาก็เริ่มมีสื่อที่เก็บค่า
We can see that
the
international news agencies are now open for subscription. You know, for example, you can now pay to watch the content from this particular news agency. So this is something that we may have to
take. ในบ้านเราเนี่ยสาเหตุก็เพราะว่าการเข้าถึงข้อมูลที่มันถูกต้องกว่านิ่งกว่าและจริงกว่าในบ้านเราเนี่ยยังเป็นอุปสรรคนะครับเอาเฉพาะประเด็นการเมืองนะครับที่ผมทำงานอยู่เนี่ยก็จะพบว่าการเข้าถึงข้อมูลที่มันที่คนมันอยากจะรู้เนี่ยมันอ่อนไหวเนี่ยมันเข้าถึงไม่ได้นะครับตัวอย่างเช่นมีการยื่นขอให้ขอทราบบัญชีทรัพย์สินของพลเอกประยุทธ์นายกรัฐมนตรีเนี่ยถึงวันนี้ก็ยังไม่ได้นะครับก็ไม่ได้เปิดเผยนะครับหรือว่าผลรายงานของปปช.ที่ตรวจสอบการครอบครองนาฬิกาของพลเอกประวิตรเนี่ยถึงวันนี้ก็ยังไม่ได้มานะครับก็สู้กันมา 4-5 ปีแล้วนะครับหรือว่าที่เราเคยทำนะครับที่ไอรอเคยทำก็คือเราขอดูรายงานการประชุมการคัดเลือกสมาชิกวุฒิสภาชุดปัจจุบันเนี่ยก็ได้มาแบบ3หน้านะฮะคัดเลือกคน200คนเนี่ยได้มา3หน้านะครับมันก็คงไม่ใช่นะครับหรือว่าสื่อที่ดีเนี่ยเมื่อเข้าไปทำข่าวในประเด็นทางการเมืองเนี่ย ก็จะถูกตีกรอบหรือว่าถูกจัดระเบียบนะครับชัดเจนนะครับตัวอย่างเช่นเวลาไปชุมนุมเนี่ยสื่อจะต้องถูกบังคับให้ใส่ปลอกแขนแล้วก็จะต้องอยู่ในบางที่พอถึงเวลาเนี่ยตำรวจจะจับละจะจับคนละนะครับตำรวจก็จะเอาตำรวจควบคุมฝูงชนเนี่ยมายืนกั้นออกแล้วให้สื่อห่างไปประมาณ50เมตร100เมตรแล้วห้ามเห็นภาพตอนจับกลุ่มนะครับพ
อ so we cannot broadcast the
okay ไม่น่ามีปัญหาต่อค่ะต่อค่ะขออภัยค่ะ
ครับแล้วพอสื่อไม่สามารถถ่ายภาพตอนถูกจับได้เนี่ยเทียบกับคนที่เขาถูกจับแล้วเขาไลฟ์เองเนี่ยคนก็ไม่ดูสื่อคนก็ต้องไปดูไลฟ์ของเจ้าตัวที่ถูกจับนะครับมันก็จะเป็นภาพที่ครบถ้วนเล่าเหตุการณ์ได้มากกว่านะครับหรือว่าทุกวันนี้เนี่ยเวลาไปศาลนะครับเวลาไปศาลในคดีสำคัญสำคัญจะต้องผ่านโต๊ะข้างหน้าลานจอดรถก่อนถ้าบอกว่าเป็นสื่อมวลชนมาจากสำนักนี้นะครับคุณยืนอยู่ตรงนั้นเลยนะฮะคุณยืนอยู่ตรงนั้นเลยทั้งที่การพิจารณาคดีเนี่ยต้องเปิดเผยเมื่อเปิดเผยเนี่ยสื่อต้องเข้าได้ประชาชนเข้าได้สื่อเข้าได้เอามารายงานได้แต่ปรากฏว่าถ้าเป็นสื่อนี่คือรอข้างล่างนะฮะแล้วรอทุกอย่างเสร็จเรียบร้อยแล้วนะครับแล้วเจ้าตัวเดินลงมาจะแถลงอะไรก็แถลงถ้าไม่แถลงหรือว่าแถลงไม่ครบก็แล้วแต่ว่าสื่อไม่สามารถเข้าห้องพิจารณาคดีได้นะครับก็เป็นเรื่องแปลกนะครับหรือว่าในห้องประชุมสภานะครับในห้องประชุมสภาเนี่ยมันจะมีที่นั่งสื่อมวลชนอยู่ด้านบนใช่ไหมครับแต่ปรากฏว่าพอมันมีสื่อมวลชนเข้าไปเนี่ยก็จะถ่ายภาพที่นั่งว่างนะฮะหรือว่าสมาชิกหลับนะครับอะไรเงี้ยก็เลยไม่เปิดนะฮะก็เข้าไม่ได้นะครับหรือว่าห้องประชุมกรรมาธิการของสสเนี่ยซึ่งก็ควรจะเปิดเผยนะฮะเราเคยไปแล้วเราก็โดนไล่ออกมานะฮะให้นั่งข้างนอกนั่งนอกห้องซึ่งนอกห้องเนี่ยมีการถ่าย
out in the room we have to sit in front of the room and we have to basically broadcast from the screen that is showing the what is happening inside the meeting room so that's basically you know this is how we present something that is actually happening at the scene or at the meeting that is you know that is important so basically we have to provide like a better access of information to the public. And also over the last year, we have seen many civil unrests and, you know, activities by the people and there are violence being used, about 100 times, I would say. And what happened is that the press cannot stay after curfew. It has been relaxed, you know, a while after that. But, you know, if we cannot stay after curfew, it means that we cannot get the story. And we basically have to stay behind the police line. And there are basically three zones of the police lines that we have to stay like at the one at the far back. And basically we cannot get the story from that location. And also, you know, the independent press, they are more allowed, they are more free to get over the police line in order to cover the stories. And there are also other circumstances where we wear the armband and we wear the vest and helmet, but we are somehow targeted by the police officer. We are shot by the rubber bullet and, you know, 29 of us are injured. And there is no like clear strategy, protection strategies for the press. And also, you know, in the field, the police are still treating us as the protesters. We are threatened, we are harassed, we are pointed by using the by the batons, for example, and we are arrested from going live or broadcasting live from the scene. So this is not how you should treat the press when we are basically trying to cover the stories or trying to present or report the news, especially when we are complying, you know, with all the requirements that you have set. For example, we are registered, we are complying with all the rules and regulations. So basically you're trying, the government is trying to restrict our work. And therefore you cannot really expect, you know, from the traditional press, because it is very difficult for the traditional press to really do their jobs nowadays. And also in the past, we see that there are, you know, evidence relating to, you know, the IO operation, the information operation from the military side. And at the end of 2020, the Twitter and Stanford University issued a report that they found that there is this information operation from the Royal Army of Thailand. And at the beginning of 2021, they said that Facebook also reported this kind of operation from the Royal Thai Army as well, and certain accounts were closed down. And there are leakage of information from the, you know, IO operators. And basically, I was involved in that particular coverage of news coverage as well. And we see all these kinds of information being broadcasted on social media. So if you believe everything you see on social media, or if you see that what you're, or if you think that what you're seeing is actually the truth, then basically we are now in the very difficult times about what we should believe. And also the press, we should be able to answer questions, you know, in times of conflicts, for example, instead of relying only on social media. And I think that is a long-term viability of the press as well. Thank you very much, Khun Yingxip. I would say that your comment is very significant, and also it's like open data or open source data. The press should be able to, you know, get access to things that are sensitive or things that are more political, because, you know, news that relating to celebrities or entertainment businesses are very open and very highly disclosed. But for political issues or sensitive issues, we cannot really get a hand on anything. When I talked to you on the phone earlier, there is the issue of Pegasus that I'm not sure whether there is any hacking activities occur. We'll get back to that. So I would like to now move on to Dr. Chanchira. I know that Dr. Chanchira has been involved in a number of research and also activities relating to fake news. So is there, you know, can you probably give us the an idea or the overview, you know, because we have Khun Toh or Khun Santipap from the Anti-Fake News Center who's with us as well. So it would be very good to hear from both sides. So thank you very much for inviting me, for having me in this seminar. So I joined from, you know, since the delivery of the keynote by Rachel. So the point that I would like to present first in this first round of panel discussion is basically to, you know, scale up or to build upon the things that you have already spoken, that other speakers have already touched upon. More recently, my work are more related to the civil society aspect, and I am now more, and also that involves the role of the press from the perspective of the civil society. When I was studying in the political science faculty, I want to be, you know, I'm doing something else, but now that I am working, you know, as the researcher. So anyway, I can see the phenomenon and the changes over the last 6 to 7 years. We can see that laws are now being applied or implemented to arrest or to threat the civil society, especially the press. And these legislations, one of them that I can see is that, you know, the has been more frequently implemented is the anti-fake news legislation. Also, in some countries, they have this particular piece of legislation on anti-fake news, while other countries, it may only be the one provision of the law that is included in a bigger piece of legislation. It may be included in the cybersecurity or digital security legislations, for example, or more particularly in Vietnam, they have this provision in the digital security legislation. So the recent research started to look into these legislations starting from Southeast Asia region. And we can see that within our region in Southeast Asia, at least in the, you know, from 2010, we can see more and more frequent implementation of these legislations to prevent people from posting fake news and also to punish people who posted fake news, whether by way of arrest or, you know, sentencing them to jail time. We can start it from India, Bangladesh, Myanmar, and in Myanmar, this is a subordinated law, not like a specific piece of legislation. And also in Cambodia, Indonesia, we see these kind of legislation as well. Indonesia has already defined what is fake news, and the definition of fake news was the definition of fake news was stipulated from the time of the beginning of COVID-19. And also the UMNO administration reenacted this particular piece of legislation as the Royal Emergency Decree that has been enacted during the COVID-19 time. The point here is that, you know, the trend on enacting fake news, enacting anti-fake news legislation can be seen more frequent during the time of the pandemic. You can see that many government administration are now trying to govern the distribution of the news, because we can see the fake news are causing more problem, more particularly for the public health sector, which is understandable. But the problem that we can see as a research team is that, you know, in many countries, especially in countries with somehow vague rule of law and vague good governance, the implementation of the legislation, since the provision of the anti-fake news may be overly vague, it is difficult to define what is actually fake news and fake from whose perspective. So in the context that, you know, that we're flooded by information, and also that we're in the fight, you know, we have to fight against hearsay, we have to fight against the facts. So by presenting the news as hearsay, even though how you may want to be, you know, neutral, you want to be impartial, but still, it is very difficult for you to refrain from expressing your own opinion. Sometimes people who share this particular piece of fake news may be punished. And so the definition of fake news or not fake news are quite, you know, varied. The court may say that this particular piece of information is fake, but my particular piece of information is not fake or is genuine. So the person that is pointing the finger saying that this piece or that piece is fake, you know, it's basically you are enforcing yourself, or you're trying to put yourself as the owner of that piece of information. So we're trying to look, so what is happening is that the law is being implemented in order to suppress people. The law enforcement officers, the law enforcement sector are basically saying that they are the owner, or they are the person or the agency that has a say over what is fake and what is not fake. So we started to see that, you know, during towards the more recently in the COVID-19 situation, the anti-fake news legislation have been implemented and also expanded in scope. So for example, there may be like the labeling of certain piece of information as fake news in order to prosecute or in order to punish certain persons. But more recently, we can see that it is now being used as a legitimate excuse, you know, or justification, as the measures that are being implemented or the suppression measures that are implemented to suppress people who may think differently on the internet. And we can see that more and more every day. We can see implementation of legislation. And also, as Rachel has mentioned, that, you know, the pressure that the government is putting over the internet platform in order to take down or remove certain content. In Vietnam, there is a cybersecurity law being enforced, which forces the platform to shut down their contents immediately if the government agency indicate that that particular content is fake news. So Facebook and YouTube in Vietnam are basically have to comply with this particular measures, you know, and they have to comply. I would say that the government is not really asking for collaboration, but they are basically ordering the removal of content, of certain content from Facebook and YouTube, and these two internet service provider will basically have to comply. This is just the way that you use legislation as to put pressure over the internet service provider. Also, the issue of fake news, if you can remember in Thailand a few years back, about 6 to 7 years ago, if I can remember correctly, it was in 2015. In Thailand, we made an effort to establish a single internet gateway, and the civil society basically tried to prevent that. But in Cambodia, there is this similar effort to establish the national internet firewall. And the problem with this is that the reason, the justification of the government to have the digital single gateway is because they want to control fake news. And this is the, you know, excuse. It is just one of the many justifications that falls under the national security, the controlling of public order, the prevention of hatred incitement, for example. And in Cambodia, we can see that this one justification is to prevent people from circulating or distributing pieces of news relating to the election, for example. So the government will come up with this sets of information, or this set of justification to control the distribution of content on social media platform. And basically the suppression and prevention of fake news falls under, you know, is now being used as a tool for the government to justify their actions to control the media. And also the measures that are being applied by the government, you know, the excuses on fake news is basically one of the justification for the military government. For example, in Myanmar, the government told Telenor, which is DTAC, that you have to restrict the distribution of fake news, for example. So this is just an samples of how fake news justification is now being used to suppress the media all over the world. Also, on another issue is that you can move to this next slide. On the third issue, we can see the phenomenon that, you know, the labeling of fake news to suppress the civil society and to suppress the digital presentation of the news. This is just part of the many measures that we call digital repression. And on the right-hand side, you can see that the main measures that are being applied may, you know, vary from filtering the content, blocking the content, which we can see in Thailand as well. And when I mentioned my first issue relating to the implementation of legislation or government measures to sue or to prosecute people, to threaten to harass people who may express different opinions from the opinion of the government. Also, Khun Nan and Khun Yingxi may have already mentioned, may touch upon on the next round of the panel discussion, but basically the role in the digital world, we can, especially in our region, we can now starting to see, you know, digital surveillance. It may be passive using T-monitor, you know, or using, you know, human monitoring system, or it may be automated social media surveillance system, which can be used by, you know, the government or the private sector as well. So we started to see the application of these technology and tools to filter information, especially those news with higher volume in social media. And also what is important is that, you know, to survey or to conduct surveillance on the civil society, it has become more targeted. So spyware is now being used. For example, Pegasus is just one of the cases that, you know, the Thai government is using the surveillance tool. Pegasus is just one of them. The product that the government used, you know, there are things that came before Pegasus, and also there are the evidence of procurement of these spyware. Because when you have to procure this kind of software from, you know, the service provider abroad, you basically have to procure it, and there will be evidence, and you have to basically justify it by saying that it is necessary for your national security. For example, you can use that to survey the act of the terrorist group or to basically provide national security. But once you purchase it, you can use it for anyone. You can use it with anyone. And that we can see like the surge of these kind of evidence of procurement from 2012 to 2013. And the most recent one is the Pegasus, you know, that messages have been circulated to 16 to 17, you know, activists in Thailand, whereby, you know, we do not really know in terms of the actual number of the people who have been attacked by Pegasus, because we cannot really run checks on that. But still, the content filtering, the implementation of legislation, and also the surveillance, the digital surveillance that is being conducted, I would say that all these three pillars lead to the same narrative, which is to restrict the flow of information. So in order that all the reporting or the presentation of the news will be under the surveillance or the control of the government. When you know, the government is successful with censorship or in restriction, we will see that there is another method, which is the information operation or information manipulation. By using the IO technique, this is how you monopolize how the news is presented. And also, this is how you silence the differentiating voice that may be having different opinion from what the government is trying to frame the mind of the public. This is just the overview. But I would say that the point that Dr. Aim left for us is that, you know, no matter how the suppression is being conducted in the digital world, or how, no matter how efficient it is, at the moment now, the civil society, especially the press, can now have creativity and can innovate, you know, new ways to basically change the dynamic of what we are seeing. And it is very interesting to see, because, you know, the control of news and information, no matter how the government wants to control the presentation of these news, but the digital area will always be the open space. It is open, but it can still be controlled. But the control that is being exercised over the digital platform will not be absolute. Basically, if you want to challenge, or if you want to think differently from the government, you can still use the digital platform to do that. So thank you very much, Dr. Chan Jira. Your presentation is very systematic, and also I would say that it really put what Khun Yingchi and what Khun Jira Pong has presented into perspective, and really make us understand in terms of what are the threats, what are the, you know, apart from technology, apart from fake news, there are also other threats that, you know, the media is still facing.
So maybe can you share your missions and how you can support the works of journalists, and as opposed to challenging, can you maybe tell us on what you do at the Anti-Fake News Center? How long have you been established? So we are in our third year. We're going to complete our third year in November. The establishment of Anti-Fake News Center was established not to monitor journalists or anything, but due to the proliferation because of the digital development, and why MDES has to step in. Thailand, you know, we are very reliant on the government, whether on climate or the medicine or food. So people rely a lot on information from the government. For medicine, we would focus on FDA, for example. So if there are any, for example, if there is any doubt on this bottle of water, you know, how is this water? Is this clean? Is this water clean? And how, you know, it can... So this is the reason why, if
you really can. That's why we wanted to establish anti-fake news center, you know, to be, you know, that center. So this is actually the program, you know, as we want to be that main coordinator. And we are in discussions that peoples have negative perception on that we are monitoring. So we are not in any way, you know, imposing or accusing any journalists, because that's the law enforcement is responsible for that. So the anti-fake news center is, you know, established to be that coordinating center where people can come in and we are able to coordinate and verify the doubts of the public. So we work, really, our work is very similar to journalists, because you work on Twitter trends and Google trends. So we also monitor in that manner as well. So if we have the Google trend, because we know that we need to be up to date. So people who are interested, and they would forward us all the trends. So what we do is simple logic. You know, the more it's being circulated, it is susceptible to being fake, you know, and adding their own bias, etc. So we want to be here to monitor and using that social wondering tools to see the level of engagement. And before receiving that inquiries from the people, and we would coordinate and verify that issue. And we have spent, we are spending quite some time. So if it's a food and drug, we would have to verify with the laboratory. So hearing from Kun Ying Chi, so I think everyone can be journalists, right? Everyone can be that media. So I mentioned bias. So that's very depending on people's beliefs. So people who are not true journalists and presenting something with their bias, so we need to verify that. So the anti-fake news center, every time if we verify, we're not coming back with if it's fake news or not. But we have to say if it's fact, and why is that fact? Particularly the insensitive issues. We need answer when and where this was said. So anyone who verify that fake news, we need to have that people or that entity behind that fact, that particular agency or designated person who is responsible for that, to verify that fact. Anyone verified through the anti-fake news will have to operate legitimately under the Section 14, whether... So there needs to be accountability to that as well. And there is liability for whatever is verified. But there needs to be justification and accountability, and there needs to be a press conference to prove. And we have had a few press conference under our hands with the miscommunication. So it's a wrong verification. Yes, you can say that, but it's basically miscommunication, because when we open, we mostly communicated through LINE platform. It was not systematic at first, but with a systematic way, with the systematic protocols placed in, we have gotten better. So in the initial stage, we didn't have a lot of people who can monitor that. So we initially first verify the news on the line application. So there's a lot of discrepancies. So that case was that there was a reply as a sticker through line. So we thought it wasn't okay. So we can you tell us a little bit on your process? So as a coordinator, if there's complaint, whether this is if of a fake news, so you are not answering this news, but you are going to verify this by coordinating with the agency. Is that correct? Yes. So that discrepancy occurred in first year due to line communication, but now it's not like that anymore. So it needs to be verified and people have to sign off for that. So have you actually verified the news from any journalists? It's not, it wasn't the news, but it's a news outlet or some programs from television programs. And I think I can mention that, for example, that case of the news where people actually got Pfizer in Laos. So we verify that with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and then going contacting to Laos administration. But so there has just been a warning, you know, on how, you know, we're just presenting a warning to those people presenting the news. So we do not have the authority to enforce any law because that's the responsibility of the police. So, and particularly the police cyber task force, any news that is verified as fake news, we will forward that to the police, the cyber task force. And it's up to their discretion to gauge and determine the severity of that. And they need to verify that again with the responsible agency where they're going to push through and follow up with the prosecution. We are not involved with any arrest, but we are here to verify whether it's fake news or not. And prosecution is not out of our hands. It's those people who have become the plaintiff. They need to have to go through the proper protocol or issue any warrants or subpoenas needed. So the flow is quite a bit complicated, but the Anti-Fake News Center, you are the coordinator. Yes, we coordinate and refer. So we refer that, and once we verify that, we'll broadcast that through the line or many channels. Right. So after hearing from panelists, maybe I want to now give the floor to the public prosecutor, Dr. Mark, because there's a lot of people mentioned the law or organizations or agencies where they work may be overlap or conflicting. Maybe it's worth hearing from you. An NGO or academia say that we're facing some difficult situation. So maybe we can hear from you and maybe you can elaborate from the perspective of the legislation and how we can actually keep promoting the freedom of the press.
So good afternoon, all participants and distinguished speakers on the panel. I would like to thank the UNESCO and also Chulalongkorn University for having me on this panel to exchange opinion with all of you and from, you know, different perspectives. Because, you know, from what we have heard so far, it seems like now we can see like the government interference with, you know, the press and with news reporting and so on and so forth. But I would like to share with you like the perspective on the on the, how the government would like to balance the news presentation. And as a legal practitioner, I would like to shine the light on the legal provisions. And we have this provision in the 2017 Constitution, and also the provision from the last 10 years and from 20 years ago of the Constitution can also portray the same, you know, the same spirit of law. And in the on the yellow point, on the yellow underlined part, is that it is stipulated that except by virtue of the provisions of the law specifically enacted for the purpose of maintaining security of the state, protecting the rights or liberties of other persons, maintaining public good or good morals, or protecting the health of the people. So the question is that, you know, we have to also consider the international legislation or international law as well. And the director of UNESCO have already mentioned Article 19 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And this particular piece of legislation also covered the core of freedom of expression, and you can see that they touch upon the true media through media as well. And there is a part of that also has been mentioned when he mentioned the ICCPR, which is the International Covenant on the Civil Rights and Political Rights of the People. And if you have read this article in the Universal Declaration and ICCPR, you can see that, you know, in the second paragraph, there are stipulations of exceptions because the general provision of this international legislation have not mentioned the exceptions. But the ICCPR stipulated the exception based on national security. So if we look at the international level, the ECHR also have mentioned, you know, the European Convention of Human Rights also mentioned the same thing. ECHR also mentioned national security, similar to, you know, if you can present whatever you would like as long as it does not affect the national security or does not threaten the national security. So this is basically the three columns to give you like a better picture and also the basic knowledge in terms of our constitutions. So from my perspective, you know, from the legalist perspective, if we look at the Constitution in 1997 and 2007 and 2017, you can see that the provision here are quite similar, especially between the Constitution in 1997 and 2007, except number four, which is the restriction or interference of, that there should not be restriction or interference of news report. So if you ask me, I would say that the 2007 Constitution is more open in terms of freedom of the press. But in 2017, the provision has been shortened. And from that perspective, you can see that if the government is trying to subsidize, you know, the press, the government is basically prohibited from subsidizing the news agencies. As a general rule, you know, based on these three institutions, the government cannot subsidize the press. But if the government would like to subsidize the press, you have to also bring in the MLO into the picture as well. The Auditor General into the picture as well. So if we look at this particular provision of the Constitution of 2007, comparing to the version in 2017, I would say that the foundation of the freedom of expression or is somehow more vague. And if you look at the ICCPR or the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, all these two international laws, whether at the international, regional, or national level, everything has an exception. But the question is that, you know, what we have in the Constitution at the moment, you know, that you can do this and you can do that unless it is threatening the national security. We have to ask whether or not we have the law that really provides protection. I would say that we have, but not so much as the 2007 Constitution. The problem today is that we have to ask ourselves whether the law is not good or whether the interpretation of that law is not good. And also the question, when we, you know, when we want to balance, I would like to mention a case to you. This particular case is in the US, you know, in the 911 case where, you know, the 911 case, the incident that happened in the World Trade Center. And we can see that the law that has been pushed so hard in that particular time is the privacy rights. But when there is such a case, when such a case happened, the stance of the government shifted like very abruptly, because they are taking the public good over the personal privacy. So, you know, we may use the term national security, but the law is not mentioning governmental security. So we have to focus on the national security. If the law is being, if the news is being presented and it is basically harming the stability of the government, then that does not equate national security. So we have to interpret the term national security. You know, national security is the security of the nation as a state. As a law, you know, of, as the personnel of the judiciary sector, I would say that we have to strike a balance. And as Mr. Santipap has mentioned, you know, people may provide certain information that is incorrect. We have to protect the other individuals who may be harmed by that incorrect information. But in that exercise, we have to not exercise over what we should be exercising. It should be limited only on the necessary basis. So it, back to the first question, you know, what is it because the law is not good, or is it because the interpretation of that law is not good? So, you know, the superpower country, they are now implementing all these kind of legislations that are similar to, you know, to what we have in order to control the press. Because Dr. Chanchira has already mentioned the 2019 security laws, and also Mr. Santipap has mentioned provision 14. And I would say that we have Computer Related Crime Act since 2004. And the section 14 paragraph subsection 1 has already set out the provision relating to the crime or the offense when you post something that is incorrect in the internet. And I would say that such legislations have been, you know, long existing in Thailand, not only in the constitution but also as subordinate laws as well. So we have to really try to look into the details whether it is, you know, specifically related to fake news only or not. So we have to, and also we have to look at, you know, superpower countries, for example, in the US, they are now using satellite surveillance to conduct surveillance over their people. Because if the satellite is, for example, Dr. Chanchira is now in Germany, if a satellite is now hovering over Germany and basically they collect information, it affects the jurisdiction, it affects the privacy, the rights of privacy, and but that is prohibited using the basis of national security. What I'm trying to say here is that the perspective of the nation, you know, when they are crossing the threshold, you know, in terms of the territory threshold or the national security threshold, they may use the term national security. So basically, national security should remain national security and not governmental security. And as Dr. Chanchira has mentioned, the SLAP case, you know, the strategic lawsuit against the public participation. So basically, SLAP case is, you know, when you interpret the law, and if you expand the scope of the legislation, and you try to interpret that certain act is committed in order to, you know, use that information to harm or to prosecute people and to basically silence or censor the people, from my perspective, I would say that this is not being used only in Thailand, but globally. There are many countries that are exercising the SLAP measures or SLAP strategy for the benefit of the government. I What I'm trying to say here is that there is a gap in the law that really allows the use of slap case. But if the slap case is used, you know, with ill intention, then it basically will help people to prosecute the public participation. It will lead to the censorship of the general public and of the press. Mr. Yingxie has already mentioned, you know, the lower or the higher threshold or ceilings among the press. So basically, there is, you know, the level of different level of risks that the press are willing to take. For example, the, you know, the protesters may be conducting something that is unlawful and they are sued. They may do something and they may found that they violated the legislation relating to public gathering. Of course, in that case, they will have to be prosecuted. But if what you did is legal, you know, in all cases, in all circumstances, of course, you can fight back, you can counterclaim, you can counter the prosecution that you are not breaking any law. So basically, this is the mechanism of the Constitution to strike a balance for everybody in the society, whether you are an individual, you are the government agency or your government officer, or whether or not, or whether you are the press. So basically, if you are prosecuted based on, you know, the allegation that you are somehow in the scene of the crime or the scene of the unrest, you can fight back by saying, you can counter their claim by saying that you are not doing nothing wrong because you have the right to be there. So basically, if something that is not legitimate has been conducted, we have to, you know, implement with the current provision of the law that we have. So basically, most of the time, when any prosecution, you know, take place, for example, when in the case of Kun Yingxie said that, you know, I'm not going to stamp, you know, I'm not going to allow to do the fingerprinting because I'm not doing anything wrong, then, you know, there is a Supreme Court case a few years back that, you know, in this kind of circumstance, by not obeying, by not being obedient with the, you know, the order of the public officials, it may deem like you are now trying, you are basically violating more and more legitimate actions. For me, I would say, you know, as law enforcement officers or law enforcement practitioners who are implementing the law, there may be, you know, some wrong interpretation of the legal provisions nowadays. So instead of having the law to protect, you know, the people or to protect the general public, now the law can somehow be interpreted to instead protect the government officials. As I have mentioned that there is, you know, international law, regional law, and also national law, and there are interpretations of law that, you know, that there are exceptions. So we have to really consider that exception, whether or not it can be taken out or not. So that is very intensive. I would say that, you know, even, you know, for the press, they may be somehow prosecuted, they may be somehow, you know, arrested by public officials. They can still counterattack or counter the offense if they are sure that they are conducting their performance legitimately. So can you tell us, like, the cost, you know, of how to fight back, you know, on the basis of human rights? It may, you know, consume both time and money. Anyway, we have very little time left, and I know that, you know, all of you try your best to present. So I would like to go back to Dr. Chirapong, since today is a World Press Freedom Day. So my question is that, you know, we are now in the period that in a very risky situation for the press. So I would like to ask all the panelists to come up with one risk or one challenge that you think are significant. So for me, I would say that personally, we are at risk of unemployment, you know, as an individual, but as the, you know, organization, we are at risk of being prosecuted by the government. You know, we don't want to be sued by the government. But if you are like the platform provider, if you're a Facebook, if you're YouTube, you're the biggest challenge for you is to be banned by, you know, in certain country. So this is something that, you know, even though you may be producing a very good content, but it's illegitimate or it's breaking the policy or the rules of Facebook or of YouTube, and now your account is somehow banned. That is, you know, the nightmare of content provider. Also, there is one thing that I failed to mention earlier is that, you know, the community of the press in Thailand nowadays, we are under the order of the NCPO from, you know, many years back in 2014, and there are enactment, you know, drafting of bills to revoke the order of the NCPO. But this particular draft, it didn't go anywhere because it has been overturned by the parliament. Also, there is an order of the, you know, the under the 27 emergency decree in provision number 11. And also in number 29, it says that the provisional protection may be granted, but somehow that has been overturned by the government as well. But in this particular 27th emergency decree at number 27, a letter has been issued to the Prime Minister and also the director of the CCSA, but to revoke the emergency decree. But until today, the emergency is still in effect, even though it has been, you know, clearly stated that this particular emergency decree is in violation of human rights. And there is a provision saying that the presentation of news or reporting of news through newspapers or medias that contain statements that may cause panic or may cause that may cause panic among the general public in the emergency situation. The TJA also issued the letter to the Prime Minister to revoke this particular emergency decree. So basically, we are not getting any feedback from the government. And this is just me trying to say that, you know, on behalf of the TJA and also other press association that are working tirelessly to have this emergency decree removed, because it really deprives the people and also the freedom of the press from exercising our rights. Also, I would like to just leave it with the anti-fake news center that this particular piece of legislation are not, you know, really efficient for the current circumstance. Okay, and I can see a hand raised by Dr. Chan Chira. The floor is yours. There are two issues that I would like to mention. The first one is the, this is to the Mr. Jirapong and also the Kun Santipa from Anti-Fake News Center. There is a research that has been conducted based on the anti-fake news legislation implementation in 20 countries. And we found that the legislation being implemented, we can see that the rate of harassment against anti-fake news are basically lower. So this is just to say that, you know, the threat of fake news that are faced by the country with the implementation of this law is not as high as those countries that do not have the anti-fake news law. And this is saying something about having the anti-fake news legislation. Also, I have interaction with comments from Mr. Mark and also the comment from the chat box as well. I would say that, you know, when you are asking the question about how should we implement the law, from the perspective of Kun Mark, I believe that as the law enforcement, you know, official, how to implement the law, we have to really take into account the political system of that particular jurisdiction. So if we are a democratic country, we have the rule of law. It means that when the law is implemented, it will be implemented across the board. Everybody will be under the implementation of that legislation. But if we're not a democratic country, the punishment or the effect of that particular law may be different from one person to another. One person may be punished under this particular piece of legislation, why others don't. So the next question is that, you know, for IO that has been mentioned, why are there no prosecution against IO? This is something we have to consider, you know, so we have to really come back and think whether or not the law that we have are really to be implemented against the innocent individuals or whether, you know, against the people who are basically IO operators, because there are impunity from, you know, the people who are the operators of all these information operations. We have to consider this, you know, as the point, a very important point, but because whether or not you are left wing or right wing, when you are sharing information that are harming the national security, you will be prosecuted. So basically, but it may not be so in certain countries that are not democratic. And this is something that is very important that we have to think about. So it comes back to us that we have to really think about the question in terms of whose security are we protecting? So Dr. Mark, do you have anything to add? Well, thank you very much for your comment. I do agree with your comment. And I have to say that, you know, I would like to mention about the structure. We may have heard, you know, about a case about, you know, we have a very distinct the legal process, for example, the arrest, the comprehension process, the prosecution process, the conviction process. Basically, in other countries, prosecutors are the only one that can prosecute the case. But in Thailand, the general public can prosecute the case as well, you know. So in Thailand, if there is a case, apologies, the audio quality is very low. So basically in Thailand, we allow the people to file a case directly to the court. So if you think that there is sufficient evidence to prove that the case, the offense has been conducted, then you can file a case by yourself. If you think that there is sufficient evidence, you can, you know, you can contact a lawyer and have the case filed to the court. As you, Dr. Pichitra has mentioned about the cause, about the slap case. You know, if you are an innocent person, there is no cost that will incur if you are an innocent person. But the point mentioned by Dr. Chanchira about, you know, why there is no prosecution against the IO or against a certain person, I would say that you have to look back, you know, whether or not the case has actually been filed. And if it has been filed, by whom? Because it is not restricted only to public officials to file a case to the court, because the general public can file a case to the court. And that is the space that has been open for the general public. If they are not relying on the public prosecutors, they can file a case themselves. So that is something that we have to educate the press as well about this particular, you know, right to file the claim. So Kun Ying Shi, I want to go back to you, since you are a content creator and you are now with iLaw. Do you have, like, you know, as Mr. Chirapong has mentioned, that about the risk of the Thai media and their risks about, you know, the orders of the NCPO and the emergency decree that is now in force. So from your opinion, what is the risk or the challenge, you know, as today is the World Press Freedom Day, what is the risk that you think the press is facing?
So what I am currently facing right now is actually the threshold. We have a lot of people prosecuted for the Section 112. And while we are speaking, the two people has been incarcerated, Khun Bai Po and Mung. So what we want to know is what they say that violated that provision 112. I only know half of that, but I don't know if I can tell people about what they said. In my personal opinion, there's so many charges that is not a violation or defamation in any way, but I can't say anything because, you know, people has been prosecuted, but I'm still doing self-censorship. So the case with clear violation is the information operation by the military towards me. My name is on the list, and I have filed the case to the administrative court. I want to stop the IO operation. And I hope that the military will not be aggressively defend against me. Maybe Khun Tho, can you maybe help a little bit with this IO operation? How do we report this to the anti-fake news center? Oh, honestly, it's really not our mission. So we receive any complaints or quest inquiries. We are operating on the IFCS, International Fact Checking Network. So we, in order to be part of IFCF, we have to be an independent organization. So yes, we do. I do like the idea of being independent. And it's a funny story. I have went to an event and Andrea talked from Taiwan. And they have their own co-fact, but they are interested in this model that we are part of MDES. And they are sending some people to our office because they didn't want an independent organization because they have had their own pitfalls as well. But they're really interested in this model as being part of the MDES. And we do have different cultures and they won't be able to do that because maybe they're far progressive, but IO is not one of your missions, right? The anti-fake news center, we cannot dismiss any case. The contents can be forwarded to us, but in connection to what I've said about being independent organization is whenever we verify or proof or fact check any news, if we want to verify about IO, there might be some delay, right, in verifying back, and there will be biased, and sometimes they don't verify that back at all. And some people think our center is not impartial because we do send them in for out for verification, but it is in their discretion to reply or not because we don't have enforcement authority. There is a lot of misunderstanding on how we are assisting the government. But it is also the liability of the people or the accountability of the people who has the ownership of the news. Because we are the coordinator, if you verify that, we can disseminate the news for you. So maybe I can maybe come back to Dr. Mark. When we talk about IO, it is quite problematic. So if anyone experienced any IO operations, what can we do? How can the government protect us?
So
I think we look at the mechanism, the Constitution have indicated clearly on the liberty when they apply that in IO operation, they will just say this case is exceptional and it is actually affecting the national security. And that's how they interpret the security. If they interpret in really broadly, they'll prosecute. So Khun Ying Shib, you said that you filed that to the administrative court and that you might face the defense from the prosecutor. Hypothetically, if a public official is being sued because their defense is that they're operating on for the national security, and that's in accordance with this clause of exemption. So I'm not saying that they are enforcing this. So there's this mechanism of exemption. So maybe I want to throw this back to the universities or academic institution. So when I was in the UK, there is a lot of Les Majestés case coming in, and it existed all over the country, all over the world, and there was an order. So at the end of the day, it wasn't from the Royal Thai Police. There are some periods of in time where these cases are interpreted very broadly, or and sometimes it's not. So this is actually an example. I am not sure that people are what they are claiming, because that order is administrative order. So administrative court has the authority, but with that reason, the prosecutor will have to go back on how they interpret the legislation. Well, today we have limited time, and we are really not have not really opened the floor. We see a lot of people asking questions in the chat, and it has been monitored by Kun Chanjira. But I think we are coming towards the end of our panel discussion for the World Press Freedom Day. All of the panelists, only Kun Jirapong is a journalist. Kun Yingchi may be an influencer, or maybe you will be interpreted as a journalist by the NBTC. So we have professional journalists. We have influencer or user-generated content journalists. So you can see the complexity of the digital landscape right now. And as a professor, I think the Thai media is very much going through a lot of repression in terms of the business or digital, and also their laws and legislation. There's a lot of digital repression. And we don't know if the law itself or the interpretation of that law. So with this, I think we're not cornered in any way. And interestingly, it has been said that despite the fact that there is fake news online, but you really can't repress us digitally. There will always be a way out. And what has been mentioned by Dr. Aim, so the social media is actually generating very high revenue, and it's great to hear that they'll be able to thrive. And yesterday we talked a little bit about OTT with the digital TV is just transitioning, but the real thing is over the top platform that exists online, and it's a really strong trend, and the Thai media is shifting towards online, which will ever be more complex, and we always need to brace ourselves for that and be resilient. So thank you very much, all honorable panelists, five of you, for being here with us. And thank you, Kunnatha Gomolawatin, the news anchor from Thai PBS, who moderated the first session. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. It's a World Press Freedom Day, and it's a day where we honor all journalists who work for the public good, whether if you're online, if you're UGC or professional journalist. Thank you for being here. I'd like to close now this panel discussion. Thank you.